Hello, welcome to Pantheon of the Geeks. You join us for an unboxing of the Triumvirate of the Imperium box set.
Yep, here it is.
Here it is.
With silver shiny writing.
Posh.
That's how posh it is.
Mm-hmm.
The Gathering Storm.
Ooh.
We also have this art card because we pre-ordered it. Of, is it Call, his name? This guy.
That dude.
Call. Which is an Inquisition. Was it Inquisition? That's the Mechanicum symbol.
Mechanicum symbol, right?
Yeah. Archmagus Dominus Belsarius Call, Tech Priest of Mars, to be precise.
That dude.
So that's an art print. It's quite a nice
it's
art
quite
print.
Quite nice, actually, yeah.
Do a frame in that.
Mm, definitely. So,
okay, so here is the box. There are five miniatures in this box, because obviously there's those two sisters there.
Celestine.
Turn it around. You can see we have Celestine and Eleanor
And Genevieve.
We have Belsarius, we just mentioned, and we have Inquisitor Greyfax. Mm-hmm. All three of those models, or five of those models, should I say, are in here.
Mm-hmm.
So let's... actually, it's yours, so
mine.
Shall let you open it. Okay. Also, there'll be another video going up after this, just so you know, we've got the book as well, so we're going to have a quick look at that before I read it. So there'll be a quick review before, and I might do another review after. So at least we can have a look at the rules for these guys. I might do that in a separate video, because it's... Might take a while. Oh, that's cool.
That's a cool box. That is funky. Yeah, so you have to undo it at both ends.
Yeah.
Which
that's a cool little box. Might keep this one.
Oh, yeah, that's really nice. That I like the picture actually. It's pretty funky.
Just a surprise. So now we've got another box.
To open. Okay.
It's a box within a box. It's like Inception.
Yeah. I have to do this as carefully as possible because I don't want to ruin the box. It's such a nice artwork on it. It literally is a box within a box. We've got a plastic box in here as well.
So cross, there'll be another box, and then there'll be another box,
oh,
and then we'll actually go through there.
That's nice.
So we have another art print.
I like that.
All of them together.
That's brilliant.
That's really nice, actually.
That'll be framed.
Sweet.
Definitely. That's going up on the wall.
That's nice. I was surprised actually.
I didn't
realise there was another art print in there. So we have a
colour.
It appears, full colour maybe. Yep, a full colour set of instructions. And we have said sprues. So we have that looks like one of the sisters.
Yeah.
Then we have the other sister and parts of Celestine and then the wings for, I think that's all of Celestine actually. We have a base.
Yeah, that is all Celestine.
We have part of Call there. We have the rest of him. that's his base. And we have, that'll be for Celestine. And then the other two sisters. And we have Greyfax and there's a single sprue there. So, which one would you like to put together first?
Well, that's a no-brainer, isn't it, really?
Or do you just want to do it in order?
Yeah, St. Celestine first. That's the order, isn't it?
Yeah,
St. Celestine, look.
That's Belsarius. So Belsarius is...
We'll do Belsarius first, because that is first.
Right. So I'll move all these bases out of the way. I'll give this some sprues before we do it.
One heck of a big base for him.
Yeah,
he's going to be massive, isn't he?
He's going to be a lot bigger. Love that way. What axe he's got.
Let's have a look, see.
Look at that. We'll see it better when it's off the sprue. But... Sweet.
Nice.
And then we have this one. Is that his solar gun weapon type thing that he's got? Wow.
There's a few little pernickety bits in here, isn't the very fine, thin
yeah,
bits?
Yeah, this is going to
so
be a knife job.
It's going to be a...
All these cables and everything.
Yeah,
it's going to
be definitely
a knife job.
Careful with this one.
So, we have the instructions. And we'll be back in a second. Okay, so we have part three here. There it is. To look at that. The join on that just reminds me of a Tyranid.
I was thinking that as well.
If you look at it, just the way it's got the... It's like
the
an armour carapace, and then
yeah.
It's got like the... It's such Tyranid-y, doesn't he?
I was thinking that when I saw it, yeah.
Wow.
I was going to say something to you, actually, about it reminding me of a Nid.
Maybe the Dragon of Mars is actually a Tyranid. There we go. We all thought it was an Necron. Then we have part 6, which is like this little claw. Then we have part 5 over here, which is a foot, by all appearances. You can see that one. So, first up, this bit. Where does that go? Right, there's a little nodule. Where is it? Yeah, so it goes in there. So there's a little hole there for that to go into. So that fits into there. And then this bit, I think, goes in front of it because there's a little nodule just there. And that bit's going to fit into there. So we'll get those bits on. And then we'll need part 4. Okay, so those bits are stuck in. So hopefully you can probably make it out better than I could explain it. That crosses over from there to that side. And then that bit sits in there. It's quite obvious how they go. They only fit in one way, so that's quite good. The next piece is part 4, this bit here. And that has two little notches there, which match up with those two little bits coming out of there. So that needs to stick onto there. The next piece after that is part 2, which is some more of these mechanical Tyranid size and mechanical. He really does remind me of mechanical.
It does. Tyranid. We were just saying that.
I'm really. I'm like, oh, is this like a nod to something that we haven't heard about yet?
Mm.
The fan theories are now flying in this room. So we'll get these bits on, and then we should be up to the where are we now. That's part 1 and part 2. Then those two bits will go together, won't they? And there's little nodules. I don't know, nodules along there with little bits there that'll stick into all the way along. So it should come together and look like this. So we'll get to that stage. If there's any issues, I'll be back in between. Otherwise, we'll see you here. Okay, so here is the basic body, which I defy anyone to say it doesn't look niddly. I said the fan theories are flying, though.
They are.
Are the Tyranids actually a product of the Mechanicum? Is the Mechanicum a product of the Tyranids? Who knows? Who dares to dream? That's awesome. Anyway, from a model perspective, ignoring our made-up lore, it looks amazing so far. And that's just the first part of the body. I like the fact it doesn't look anything like the other Archmagos. Okay, so 2A is pipes, part 9, which will fit underneath here by the looks of it. And then we have 2B, which is this. Not to be, which looks like, again, underneath. Looks like his tail, stomach section, whatever we're talking about there. So 9 and 10 are next. So we'll get those two bits on the underneath part. And I'll take it from there. Okay, so those are the pipes, and there's the under part with the all the other cables coming off at the front, all in place though. You can see that. Next up, we have part 15, which is this sort of valve on the back, and part 16, which sort of connects onto it somehow. If we turn it over, we can see there are little grooves in there, which this should fit into. I've not even tested this yet. It looks like it goes on there, which it does quite nicely. So we'll stick that on, and we'll stick part 16 on as well. And next up, we have the parts. So we've got this middle grooves here where they go on, and then we've got three little grooves at either side of that, where part 13 and 14 go on to. So we'll get those bits on as well, and that brings us up to here. So we'll be back once we get there. Okay, so we can have a look at this bit we've just done. Part 16 goes that way around, and the cable goes pointing up into, well, nowhere at the moment. This bit at the back also goes that way, and 13 and 14, those cables sort of slip in and fit in with part 15. So you end up with it looking like that. So next we have these two bits, 17 and 18. they need to go together, and then they need to fit onto the side of part 15 by the looks of it. And then we have parts 12 and 11, which need to go on this front bit. I bet the front has got like two little square cutouts at either side, so that looks like they stick onto that. So I'll do these two bits, and I'll be back with you. Okay, so here we are. So we've got this floaty skull thing on the back, first off. That goes on, there's a tiny little hole in the part 15 earlier, and a tiny little peg on part 17 which fit in. And it's at a weird angle, I think that's the right angle when you look at the picture. So the skull's sort of over this engine part. Like he's about to go and have a look at it for him, keep him monitoring it or something. And then we have this thing coming out the front of him, which is like a tiny weird metallic crab thing. Which is just sort of like flying from underneath his robe, like coming at you like a shrew. That's terrifying, actually.
It is. It's like he's walking his pet or something.
Yeah. Taking his little pet metallic crab thing for a walk. It's amazing. The level of intricacy on this is wow.
Yeah.
So next up, we have one 2H. And we'll just put those bits on. So we have a book, which is made of 7 and 8. And that goes onto the base, and then this bit attaches to the base. So his foot is on top of the book.
And you've got 49 as well on there.
So we'll get him stuck on, and then he's in place. And then we'll move on to start the body, which is 19 and 20 and 21. And then all these other bits, but we'll get back to it. We'll get him onto the base.
You missed part 49 on there.
This bit there. missed what?
49.
I've missed what? How dare you? Part 49 is like a little
lantern.
Lantern or some sort of electric Tesla coil or something like that. Some sort of ancient alien technology, part 49. And that fits onto there. There's two little grooves on the back. So we'll get that on, we'll get them on, and then we'll be back for the body. Okay, so while that bit dries and adheres to the base, we should continue. So we have part 19 and part 20. Those two bits will just stick together, like so. We have part 21, which goes on this side here. Not sure why that bit's separate, but it makes up the lower body. Then we have this part 23, which is that bit there. And you can just see it's 23 on the instructions. They've sort of printed the 23 over the top of the picture, weirdly. Then we've got 27, which is this little bit here. 24, which I believe is the bit that goes, I think it goes on the back. Or does it go on the front? Let's have a look at that. It does fit, it would fit on the back. Then we have part 22 there. So yeah, that is, just looking at the next picture, that is the bit that goes on the back. So you can see here, the little 27 goes on the top. 23 is actually his face, and we'll go on there. And 22 will go on this bit. I've got my thumb on holding it on, attached around there. So we'll get all these parts together, and then I'll come back and you can see what it looks like together, and we can start on the gun next. Okay, so here is the upper body. So you can see that wire went on there. We've got the back piece going on there, this bit on there, and the face goes on that bit there. That bit is done, we're ready for the next part, which is the gun. So that consists of part 39, 38, 40 and 41, at which point the whole thing gets stuck onto the side of the body. So we're going to do this bit and then we'll be back. Okay, so there is the gun attached, so it attaches onto that lower bit there. And one of the wires goes onto the back, another bit goes onto the pack area, backpack bit, or generator, or whatever that is. So that's so far. So next up, onto the next page, onto 3E. So this consists of part 31, which is the keys, which this was one of the rumours that the Games Workshop did from their Warhammer TV. One of the little key ones, so that is 31. They've got another arm here, which is in the robe, which is part 37. We have another hand, which consists of part 36 and part 35. So those two parts go together to melt on, and then they all stick together. So we'll do that, and then we've also got part 28, which goes on the opposite side of this. There's a little groove there with two holes. Why are you laughing?
Because I'm trying to eat a crisp.
I know you are. Really quietly. It's really hilarious. And then we've got part 29, which is like a little arm with a attachment on the end. And that goes onto this little bit there. So we'll get all these bits off as well, stick these on, and that'll bring us to this bit here.
I'm now eating my crisp. You all right?
Yeah, that was the quietest crisp eating I've ever had.
Thank you.
It's all right. So we'll be back in a second. So, getting hard to actually pick him up without bits falling off him like that. There we go. So we've got the other arms on, and then we've got this bit on the front. Next up is the next arm. He's got so many arms, it's unbelievable. We have part 42, part 43, and then part 44. So this is part of this claw here, this like power claw thing he's got. So those three bits will go together to make that. We have part 32, which goes onto this front bit here. We have part 30, which is yet another arm, which goes underneath part 32. And we have part 33, which is another arm, which goes there. And then we have parts 25 and 26, which are like another servo skull attachment, which goes on this top bit here. There's a little groove in there for that. So we'll put all those together, and then we'll be back when we're down to the next stage. Okay, so we've now got that arm on, we've got the walking stick arm on, we've got the data slate arm on, which is just basically an arm holding the data slate. Then another small arm, which is using the data slate. And then we have the other servo skull, which goes on the top. Now, all on there. They all fit into very specific grooves. You can see where they are. It's actually, considering how complicated it looks when you just look at it, it's really easy to put together. So now we have the last of the arms, which is part 34. I believe it's the last of the arms anyway. Might not be, but I think it is.
It certainly looks like it, yeah.
Yeah. Part 34, which is the one that's holding this spunky staff. There it is. So we have like a little bit coming off, and we have the arm, and there's one slot left for that, and then the plug for that goes behind it. So it'll just be a case of fitting that onto there, onto there on camera, because there's bits, they're still drying. So another good tip for this is wait while bits dry, because there's literally nothing else to hold on to. I'm literally holding on to the only bit I can, which is that bit coming off the top. So it's really difficult to position things. So I'll wait for them to fully dry first, or they'll just fall off. Okay, so we'll be back once I've got that on. Okay, so there is the arm, which fits on there. The wire goes underneath all this lot, and there's actually a little plug for it just underneath here on the main body at the back. You see where that wire goes into there. So that goes on there. So now it needs to dry. Now we do the last sort of part, which is his hood, which actually consists of part 48. 45, 47 and 46. So we've got like a little speaker phone, which is obviously how he speaks. And then we have part 45, which is part of the hood and the connections to that. Then we have part 46, which is the other part of the hood. And we have this little wire on the other side. All those go together to make that, which then sticks onto or over his face. So we have this sort of blank piece there with the head sort of jutting out. So the hood's going to go over that. And then we're going to stick all that onto the body, which is now quite dry and stuck to the base, which is there, onto that gap there, not there. So we should finish building him, and when we come back, he should be done. Just before we finish him off, I actually wanted to show you how intricate the hood was on its own. It's got a massive vox in front of his mouth, and then he's got this speaker up there. That on its own, just the amount of detail that's in that. So we'll stick that on, and we'll be back in a second. Here he is, finished. That is an amazing model, just for sheer amount of bits that are on it. It's so busy, but it works. It's not busy in a, oh, there's too much there, because he's what he is. He's just a mass of wires and limbs and weapons. He's exactly what an Archmagus should be. The model is amazing.
It is. It's...
For me, that's like almost, we're only in January, it's like miniature of the year material. So whatever else they bring out this year is now going to be measured against this for me. It's just awesome. We'll see him again at the end, but I'm just so impressed. There's so much detail in there. I want one for myself now, because this one's closed. Wow. I convert into dark mech. That'd be amazing. I wouldn't need to do any conversions on him, just like painting my dark mech colours.
Oh. Still looks like a Terminator.
They might bring him out independently later, who knows. He does, that's the thing.
From the back, just turning round to the back so he's facing the camera, that bit there looks like a tail, and his feet look very Tyranid-like.
And his armor carapaces. I mean, we might just be... Cause
it might just be the way the model is.
It might just be the fact that...
you can't see any human bits on him at all.
I mean, obviously, Tyranids, they evolve to the pinnacle of evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe obviously, the Mechanicum, they sort of like do the pinnacle of machine evolution. So maybe it's actually the same conclusion that those come to for design.
Mm.
It's weird though, but it's amazing.
Mm, it's an amazing model.
Yeah. So, there we go.
Mm-hmm.
So, we'll move on now. Actually, what we'll do first in here are actually the rules for him. If you want to have a look. Let's see, weapon skill, list skill 5, strength 5, toughness 6, wounds 5, initiative 3, attacks 3, leadership 10, and 2 up save. He has Arc Scourge, Mastercrafted Power Axe, a Mechandrite Hive, a Scryer Skull, a Refractor Field. He's got the Canticles of the Archmagos and Canticles of the Omnissiah, Field of Aim, independent character and very bulky. He has the Artificer Self-Repair Mechanicums, which means he basically recovers D3 wounds every turn. So he's going to get one wound at least back every turn, and then possibly three. And then we've got Masterwork Bionics, which is making him re-roll Feel No Pain rolls as a Warlord trait. So there we go. And then he's got the Arcanium Mechanicum, which is the Solar Atomizer. There it is. So that is range 12, strength 10, AP 1, Assault D3, Mastercrafted Melter.
Wow.
Yep, there we go. That's how you kill something big. Right. 200 points for that lot. Moving on. Celestine.
Yay!
Bit Claire's been waiting for. So, we've got Sprue.
Celestine. I think that's Celestine.
With 1 and 2 on.
Yeah.
There's one. Yes, here is one of the sprues for Celestine. I think some of the other parts are on the ones with the other sisters on.
Yeah, I think they're...
yeah, so it's spread across. She's spread across the three sprues. Cool. So we need parts 1 and 2 to start with.
Yes.
Yeah. Part 1 and 2, which is the main part of her body and one of her legs. So those bit go on there, I believe. Is that right? Or is it like that? I think that'll be good. Yeah, there's a little line there under the leg. Must go on that one. Is that right? Doesn't feel right. Alright, got it. Sorry, that looked a bit weird on the thing. The tabard bit goes there. And then the legs goes on that one. Yeah. Like so. Then we have part 3. She goes onto her back, so it goes into that little slot there. And then we have the front part of her body and her head. Is it her head?
Mm-hmm.
So her hair is a bit separate. We're getting into weird territory here. Her hair is separate.
Yeah.
Whoops, there we go. And her head goes flying out your hand. So the head will go on to the front part of the body, this bit. And then those two parts will attach to that. So let's get to that stage, and then I'll be back.
Okay.
So that's where we're up to. You can see on there where the head and the body went. This bit on the back, where the tube's on, which obviously how our wings and stuff actually work. which is a nice little thought. Actually explains it with like power stuff instead of like mystical stuff. Proper 40k. Then we have the shoulder pads, which are part 6, which are there. So they're just going to go on over our armour. Then we have part 7, which I think is part of the shoulder pad, is it?
It is, yeah. It's the wings from the shoulder pad.
So that's actually separate.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
It looks like it's separate on the others as well.
Yeah. And then we have part 8, which is the sword with the flowers on. Is that flowers?
It is flowers, it's roses.
Part 9, which is another leg, and part 10, which is the lower leg. So all those should fit on pretty obviously into the slots provided. So I'll stick it together up to there, and then I'll rejoin you when we get to 5H. So that's where we're up to. See the sword on there, the legs are on. Pretty straightforward to put together so far. So next up, we're on 5H, and we have the just like the cloak. So that's got two little parts there, which attach to a derriere. And there's two little bits there for it to go onto. The buttock attachment. Then we have two little attachments on the cloak itself, which the next part will go on to, because there's a little attachment on the end of that, which is part 12. This is part 13, which also sort of stacks on top of part 12 on the same place, making like two bits that come off, like scrolls, aren't they?
Mm.
Then we have the set of doves, which is awesome in itself.
Yeah.
This little bit.
Mm.
That's cool.
I think in the original she was holding a dove.
And that attaches also onto the cloak, onto this little bit there on the edge, if you can see it, just there. And that should get us up to this stage. So let's put all that bit together and she'll be back in a moment. Okay. So here we have what I've seen so far with the doves on. We have these scroll type things on, which you see on like Stormcast Eternals. Is it the protectors?
Something like that.
The flying ones. It's a very good method of actually making something fly, but it's a bit unsturdy sometimes. But it looks great. So next up is her backpack, which consists of four parts. We have part 15, which is the backpack itself, like the power armor backpack. Part 18, which is our halo. And then 16 and 17, which are the wings. Those four pieces will go together to make the backpack, which will stick onto her, and then we'll put her on a base and she's done. So we'll just have a look at these parts. Is that part 16?
Yes, I think.
So
yes.
That's one of the wings.
Yeah.
Then we have part 17, the other wing. Part 15, which is that. And then the halo claws just cutting off. So those bits look like they go together relatively easy. They just slot in like that. So shouldn't be a problem. If there is, we'll be back in between. Otherwise, we'll be back when she's finished, because that is said, that's literally it. She'll go on to her base and we're done. So if there's any problems in between, I'll be back. Otherwise, see you at the end. Yeah, she's finished. St. Celestine. It's an excellent model.
Absolutely awesome. So much better than the original, to be fair.
Yeah. There's a lot more motion in it. We talk about motion a lot. We like motion.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also the detail and the doves and just a bit boingy, like the, like the Stormcast guys. But she's a lot smaller. She doesn't actually look like a Stormcast. She did initially when I first saw her. Very Stormcast, but she really doesn't. She does look a lot more. I think it's just because she's in gold.
Mm.
But she's smaller than she looked on the picture, really. She's definitely like Sister of Battle proper size. She's not like exaggerated or anything.
No.
Well, any more than a Sister of Battle already is. She's to scale with them. And she's pretty much the same size as the old Celestine. She's just in different, more dynamic position.
Yeah, and the wings are a lot more, I think the wings on the original are a lot more like feathers who look like feathers, were those look more mechanical?
Yeah, they do look a lot more mechanical, a lot plainer. I think that works for her, actually.
Mm.
And obviously they're not made of metal, so they're not going to fall off every 5 minutes.
That's true.
So there we go. That is Celestine. We'll see her again at the end with everybody from the box. Mm-hmm. But now we'll move on to her, I think the bodyguard or honour guard or best mates. I don't know. We've got Eleanor. So we have part 34 and part 33. We then have part 35, which goes on to that. So that's like the back of her body. That's the front of her body. We have part 36. Is that a leg?
Yeah, it's just a leg and
some MacGuffin. Then we have the shoulder pads, which are part 37 and part 38.
That leg should be on there, sorry.
We have the breastplate,
mm-hmm.
Which part 41 and part 42 is the leg. And then her other sort of like knee to foot is part 43. The little wing thing that goes on the shoulder pad again.
Mm-hmm.
That's part 39.
45 and 44.
Yep.
And then you have 40, which is like a little bit at the back.
All right.
For the wings to go on to.
And that's more like the standard Seraphim backpack.
I like the fact that they're like organ pipes.
Are they?
Yeah, if you look at them, they're like organ pipes.
They are. I didn't notice that. Is that the same as the old turf?
No, I'm sure it's not. I'll have to hunt out my sisters of battle, but...
I don't remember them doing that.
They're nothing like that.
But yeah, they are like organ pipes almost.
Yeah.
Put them that way and you can play them. Excellent. So that's basically the whole model. Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to do it stage by stage. I'm just going to stick it together. Unless there's any issues that I don't think I need to know about, I'll come back when Eleanor's done and then we can do Genevieve, who's the other one.
Mm-hmm.
So we're back in a second. So there is Eleanor finished. She went together really easily. The only thing worth noting is the sword. It's shaking a bit. Huh? The other thing worth noting is that the handle on the sword goes slightly underneath the shoulder pad. If you can see that on there. So when you glue the shoulder pad down, just leave a little bit of a gap for that to fit into.
Mm.
Luckily, because I put it together all at the same time and didn't wait for things to dry on this one. The shoulder pad wasn't dry, so I easily pushed it back up.
Mm-hmm.
But that is Eleanor.
Okay.
Looking good.
Mm.
So we'll now move on to Genevieve, who looks very similar. So we have part 20 and 19. We have part 21.
21.
Yep. We have part 22. These are almost exactly the same part.
They are.
23 and 24 are the shoulder pads, 27 for the bodice, 28 there. We've got a little icon shoulder pad, which I've no idea why that's separate. It's 25. 29 is the lower leg. Oops. Then we've got 30, which is the bolt pistol, and then we've got 13. The sword at 31. A little part for the backpack to go on is 26, and the other backpack, which is the same, is 32.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I'll put her together, and we'll be back when she's done. Here's Genevieve. The models are excellent.
Mm.
I mean, the rumour mill still says they're going to do some more Plastic Sisters. They're just not going to be coming out just yet. A shame.
Mm.
But if when they do come out and look anything like these guys, they're going to be amazing.
It kind of like does lift my heart for them coming out, seeing these models. They must have some idea of what you want to do with the sisters.
I really hope they are coming out still. I don't see why they wouldn't. These are amazing models.
Mm.
So we'll see them again at the end when we have a look at everything in the box set. But Celestine, the rules are in the book as well, which is good. So we have Saint Celestine, Weapon Skill 7, Bliss Skill 7, Strength, Toughness of 3, Wounds 5, Initiative 7, Attacks 5, Leadership 10, and a 2 plus Armour Save, Jump Infantry. She has a Gemini Superior, two of them, which is Eleanor and Genevieve. They have a Weapon Skill of 5, Bliss Skill 4, Strength, Toughness of 3, Wounds 2, Initiative 4, Attacks 2, Leadership 10, and a 3 plus Save. Wargear is a Bolt Pistol and a Power Sword for the Superior. Frag and Crag Grenades.
Mm-hmm.
Adamantium Will, so pretty much all three of them have it. Eternal Warrior is Saint Celestine only. Fearless, Hit and Run, Independent Character for Celestine only, and Saintly Blessings.
Mm.
Divine Guardians, so basically Both the superior have a 4+ invulnerable save. In addition, while at least one of the superiors still alive, resolve any wounds suffered by Celestine against them. Saint Celestine is permitted to join other units, and they join with her, or when they leave, they become a unit on their own. We have the Emperor's Vengeance, which is a one-use weapon. It's unlimited range, strength 8, AP 3, and it's an assault 1, barrage, large blast, and orbital strike. We've also got Healing Tears. So Saint Celestine can, at the beginning of her turn, start of each of your turns, a single Gemini superior anywhere can be set up within 2 inches of her, basically. So she can bring them back to life.
Oh, cool.
With her Healing Tears. And then she has Martyrdom. If a model with the Martyrdom special rule is in your, as your warlord, and that model is removed as a casualty during the battle, all friendly units wholly comprised of models with the Active Faith special rule automatically pass all leadership tests until the end of your turn. And she also has Miraculous Intervention, which is this blurb here, which basically says when she dies, you take a leadership test, and if she passes, you put a marker on the table where she died.
Mm-hmm.
And her next turn she comes back. And on the same turn she can still heal one of her Celestine.
Whoa, cool.
So you can get into a cycle of her passing the wounds onto them, then her healing them.
Yes.
She has the Beacon of Faith. All friendly models within 12 inches of Saint Celestine use a leadership value while taking Act of Faith or War Hymns tests. And she has the Argent Blade, which is a template weapon, as well as being a sword.
Master.
It's strength 5, AP 4, assault 1. The sword itself is plus 2 strength, AP 3, melee armour bane and master crafted. She also has the Armour of St. Catherine, which, I forgot what it said now, is a revered suit of golden power armour, which is worn into righteous battle by the canonised sister Catherine Elysius. The Armour of St. Catherine confers the Saint Celestine a 2+ armour save and a 4+ invulnerable save.
I think she was one of the founding sisters, if I remember rightly. I might be wrong with that.
And so there we go. That's what happens. You keep them with her. She passes the wounds to them. They die. She heals them.
Mm.
She dies. The first time she dies, mm-hmm. It doesn't work a second time. The first time she dies, she can come back on it if you pass the initial test. It's basically what that says. It goes into a little bit more about it, but that's the sort of...
Nice. Okay.
So, last up, with the single sprue, is Inquisitor Greyfax.
He looks awesome.
They've all looked awesome, these models. Mm-hmm. Even this single model here, she looks brilliant. So, we'll get the parts off. We need parts 1 and 2. And then we also need parts 3 and 4. So we'll get those off and we'll be back in a second. Okay, it's part 1. Part 2 is the sword. And that fits underneath the cape. It goes that way around actually. It fits underneath the cape. And then we have part 3, which is the front part of our armour, which will go onto that and fit over there. We have part 4, which is a leg, and then we have part 5, which is her other leg. So I'm going to get her up to this stage, where they're all together, and then we'll be back to look at the condemned bulk. So there is the body so far. Looking awesome detail-wise. The cloak's got some cool detail on it as well. So... Then we're up to that. So the Condemnabalgam is this two part, which is the bulk part and then the sort of like crossbow part, which just fits on top. Next up we have, what have we got here?
The shoulder pad.
The shoulder pad with the skull on. Let's look at that. Oop, come here. So, you see that there. That's pretty awesome. And then her hand.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just going back. Then we're up to the backpack, which consists of this bit here and like a little exhausts on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've got our head, which is two parts, the head part and then the brim of a hat, which is separate. And that's her. Quite simple. So we'll finish sticking them together and get her on a base. If there's any issues in between, I'll be back. Otherwise, we'll see you at the end. So there's Inquisitor Greyfax. There's just a little bit of stuff I need to take off a hat with a knife once that's all dried. And my sweat after I stuck the head on. Amazing. I really like that model.
They're awesome, aren't they?
Yeah. All of these models have been amazing. So cool. Right, so we'll see her again at the end. Mm-hmm. Let's have a look at the rules. So Inquisitor Greyfax. So she has a mass-crafted Condemn Bolt Gun, mass-crafted Power Sword, Frag Grenades, Grog Grenades, Psycho Grenades, and Cyclorium. Master of Interrogation. Enemy infiltrators cannot be set up within 24 inches of Greyfax. Independent character. Preferred enemy psychers. Psycho Mastery 2. Stubborn. Indomitable Will. When making a Deny the Witch test, Inquisitor Greyfax always counts as having a higher mastery level than the psycho manifesting the power.
Ooh.
Always. Psycho, Inquisitor Greyfax always knows the Aura of Oppression psychic power. She may generate two or more powers from telepathy discipline. Aura of Oppression, warp charge 1 or 3. Which basically says Greyfax crushes her foes with the undying force of her will. Aura of Oppression is... I'm just reading this sideways, so that's why it's difficult. Aura of Oppression is a malediction that targets a single non-vehicle enemy unit within 12 inches. The target unit must immediately take a pinning test. Even if this test is passed, whilst this power is in effect, the target unit cannot run, turbo boost, perform sweeping advances, or fire Overwatch. Alternatively, you can attempt to manifest this power at warp charge 3, decide before rolling. Enemy non-vehicle units within 12 inches of the caster. It affects all. Sorry, I missed that bit. Oh. So it would affect everybody within 12 inches.
Right.
They do it with one, you can pick a unit, and do it with three, you can, it affects everybody.
Wow.
So 150 points, weapon ability score 4, strength and toughness, and wounds of 3, initiative 4, attack 3, leash at 10, and the save of 3+. And that is her.
Wow.
And we have a colour palette in the back. Excellent.
Yay, cool.
That's good.
Might be using that.
And it's in colour, which is even better. So that's good work. And then we have one for Crawl. There's not one for Greyfax, unfortunately.
Oh, well.
But it's just those two. In the back, though. That's not too bad. Oh, there is one for Greyfax. Oh, yeah. I was leaning on
little
it.
Little tiddly one.
I didn't see it because I had my elbow on it. There she is. So all three of them, brilliant. Obviously, the colour scheme for the Gemini are the same as
Celestine.
As sister.
Yeah.
So let's look at the models together. There we go. The Triumvirate of the Imperium.
Mhm.
What do you think?
Really cool models.
I think you've claimed them all. So. So there we go.
Yeah.
Which one's your favourite? If I even need to ask.
Celestine.
Yeah. I like them all. They all look amazing, but Call is definitely my favourite.
Yeah. He's an awesome model.
If I could only pick one, it'd be him. But they're all amazing. Inquisitor Greyfax is as well.
She's a nice model as well. It's really hard to choose between all of them, but from my perspective, from being a Sisters of Battle player, I like Celestine. I think they've done a really good job on the new model.
Yeah. So that's it. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please like and subscribe, it helps out loads. I shall leave you one final thought though. What the hell is this? On the edge of the box there. This artwork on the box is great, but what's this thing? It looks very sort of a cross between a Tyranid and Slaanesh. It's very strange.
Yeah.
Yes.
When you start looking at the box,
there's a few weird bits on it that don't look just mechanical-y either. It's very strange. It could be a Medusa's head as well. That's the other thing I was thinking. Are these clues that we're missing? There we go. We'll find out in due course.
Yeah.
So as I said, there'll be another video coming up of the Fall of Cadia. We'll have a look at the book. Not going to go up today. This is taking ages to do this.
It has actually. I think our first model was just
a lot of bits. Yeah, I had to wait for every little bit to dry completely before I moved on. So it took ages to do this. That's why it's going up pretty late today, actually. So the book will be tomorrow, the day after. I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to give it a read first, and then I'll go come back and give it a quick review as well. So we'll see you then. Take care, guys.
See you soon.
Bye for now.
Bye.